This program was made possible by generous support from the Iraq-Afghanistan Deployment Impact Fund of the California Community Foundation. Additional funding provided by American Greetings.
Hi, Miss Queen Latifah.
Hey, hi. So good to see you.
It's so good to see you, too. Well, what brings you here to Sesame Street?
Well, I'm meeting up with some friends who've been through some pretty tough times. Yeah, they were all hurting one way or another while serving in the military. And you know, those kinds of changes can be really tough on a family, especially the kids.
Wow. Well, can Elmo meet them?
Well, sure. That's a great idea. Because the more we know about these kids and how their families cope, you know, the more we can understand what they're going through.
And find ways to help?
You got it.
Oh, good. Well, where are they, Miss Queen Latifah?
Oh, right there, Elmo.
I love my daddy to the moon and back.
When I saw my dad legs, it made me feel a little bit nervous.
I was in a drug-induced coma for 6 weeks. I got burns to my hand, my arm, second degree to my face and head.
And I'm so proud of my daddy because he fought for our country.
Sydney was almost four when I came home, and the whole left side of my face was bandaged up.
And my nana asked me if I would be scared, and I said no. And then I saw him, and I was scared.
Then she realized after Daddy talked to her, that's Daddy. That's the same Daddy that left. He just looks a little different.
She just ran up and threw her arms around me, and she didn't let go for a while. It's pretty cool.
My mom has a lot of courage.
I love my daddy to heaven and back.
This much.
He started his ABCs and 1, 2, 3s all over again because of the traumatic brain injury that he suffered.
He doesn't have no legs and one arm.
At first, I didn't think she wanted to hug me because she was scared of me, maybe. That hug made me feel so happy and complete inside that it made me feel like I didn't really lose anything at all.
When my dad came home, I was really happy. I was so happy I can't explain happy.
I took my first steps the same day as my daddy did.
He is the same old daddy because he loves me no matter what.
He's brave in every way.
He's always my hero.
I love my daddy all the way from California to New York. He's awesome.
Hola, everybody! Hola, Queen Latifah! Hola, Mito!
Hola, Rosita!
Hey, you know, Elmo tells me that you've been going through a pretty big change in your family.
Oh, yeah. My daddy got hurt. Oh, look, that's him over there. Hola, papi!
Hola, chiquita!
His legs don't work anymore.
Yeah, and that's why he needs the wheelchair.
Oh. See, and now so many things have changed. You know, at first, it was really hard. But we're figuring it out.
Well, you know, there are a lot of military families that are going through the same kind of thing.
There are?
Yeah, like the families of my friend Dave and Sam. Both of them were injured while serving, and they and their families are finding ways to deal with the changes in their lives, too.
Oh. What is all this stuff?
This is all the seaweed, low tide.
This looks like you can walk on it.
Any good shells?
I got this Indian rock.
What do you think?
Sweet.
My dad is like a big role model to me. He's just so, so inspirational. He's probably one of the most best guys I've ever met.
Have you get ready to run?
And we'd play outside even if it was freezing out. We would throw the football around and his hand would probably be like blue. And he wouldn't care. He'd just want to have a good time with us. I was a little worried that he was injured, but I don't care if he has his whole body gone as long as he's still living.
There's 1,000 things that you don't even think about trying to do with one hand. Can openers and, zipper and jackets. But at this point, I've had every possible surgery to try and get some function out of the hand, and everything's fell short. So I'm gonna amputate in about a month.
That's a very hard decision to make. Do I remove a part of my body to make it better?
It's between my index finger and my thumb, but I mean something like this pencil, it'll take me 15 minutes.
My dad is getting a mechanical hand, and when he told me, I was kind of like nervous about it, but I was really excited about it. He's gonna have a lot more capability.
Did he do it?
Yeah.
My daddy got a broken leg.
Say goodnight, Nightbook.
He has a fake leg and a real leg.
Where are you guys? Okay, no hiding. Come on.
Let's go. Let's get dressed.
When I was first injured, I did struggle for a while with the idea that I may be chasing this little kid around on crutches or in a wheelchair, because I didn't know what my future held. So I was nervous. I was afraid it was gonna change the way I was gonna be a father.
Just leave it like that.
He couldn't walk around the house with his son. He couldn't go up and down the stairs with him, you know, because he had crutches.
Right,
it's difficult for him to deal with it. And then once he got his prosthesis, and he could carry his son around the house or to the mailbox or anywhere, that just meant the world to him.
You can step on it if you want to. You step all your weight. You can jump on it.
Can I jump?
Yeah, you can jump on it.
But not on this leg.
Why not on this leg?
Because that's a real foot.
I know.
Ow! That hurts. Ow! What are you guys doing?
Kids have always considered his prosthesis almost like another toy. Sometimes Dave goes to put his leg in, and he has to retrieve whatever toys the kids have stashed in there.
I made a sock on.
Sock? Now what? So I'm ready to go?
No.
Oh, what am I forgetting? What is that?
That's your leg.
That's my leg?
My relationship with my family is something that I've been having to figure out myself for the last 5 years. I spent the first probably year and a half of my newly injured life turning to my wife and saying, are you proud of me? Was that okay? You know, am I getting there? Am I being myself again? And what I was really trying to find out was, you know, you still love me?
You know, as macho as you think you are, and that you're a U.S. soldier and you're a fighting machine, you can't, this particular fight, you can't do alone. You need that family support. You need that team.
Dad, will you get your new hand? Can you come to school first?
Yeah, come to school and show it to all the kids?
Yeah.
Sounds good to me.
I feel proud of my dad. I feel proud of the soldiers. I feel proud of everyone who has either been in the war or put their life on the line. It's just, like, awesome.
I feel so lucky. It taught me that my family is a gift. It taught me that every day is a gift. My hero is my husband. Their hero is their father.
Well, you guys are my heroes. That was a great job you did there.
Yeah. Thank you.
You're very welcome.
Daddy.
Yeah?
Is that your daddy's new hair?
Yeah.
Well, can you almost see it?
Yep, sure.
Wow! Wow, look at that. It's like a robot hand.
Yep.
Well, how does he help your daddy?
It helps my dad, like, picking up stuff and catching stuff. And, and he's just learning it now.
Can I touch it?
Sure.
Ooh, cool. I like that. You see, Rosita, a lot of families are going through changes.
I didn't know so many other people have been hurt, too.
See, but they are getting through it the same way that we are, together, as a family.
So how did you guys integrate your kids into the recovery process?
It was important for me to have both the boys at the doctor's appointments, physical therapy, even right up to the prosthetic process. This way, when I came home, they were never surprised at what was different or what was new. They were up to speed just like I was.
Yeah, because he wanted you to go to show and tell in school, huh?
Yeah. I'm sure I'm going to be real popular now, show and tell.
Dean, you have a lot of experience working with military families. How do kids react when a parent is injured?
The emotions go from anger of, why did that have to happen to my dad? Or why did that happen to my mom? Or why did it have to happen to me? All the way to the guilt of, you know, if I'd only done my homework when my dad called from Iraq the last time, maybe he wouldn't have been so upset with me and everything would be okay.
What can we who aren't in the military do to help?
Well, I think there are some things that would be very helpful to them. Some that are quick and easy things for us to do, but still mean a lot. One is to give the gift of time. Another one, the gift of attention. And the third, a gift of listening, which is so important.
You know, Quinn, another thing we could do is, you know, it's not just the active duty soldiers and Marines getting deployed right now, it's also the National Guard and Reserve. So when they come back to the communities need to be ready for them and welcome them and make them part of the community again.
Yeah, because it's different when you're in the military and you're on a base, there's a big military community.
That's right.
And the reserves and guard, they come back to just normal civilian communities, and I don't think they're quite as set up for that. So I think that's a great idea to sort of reach out and say, hey, we're here for you too.
There are so many different ways that service members may return home changed.
Yep, and not all injuries can be seen because some are on the inside.
Oh, like a stomachache?
Something like that. But sometimes it's the brain that gets hurt. That's what happened to my friend Michael. He has a traumatic brain injury and has post-traumatic stress disorder as well.
Well, he doesn't look hurt.
Well, sometimes it's hard to tell when someone's been hurt on the inside. But for the injured person and their whole family, it's just as difficult as being hurt on the outside.
I love my daddy more than I love ice cream and pizza.
On all my folders, I write, I love my daddy, I love my daddy.
I heard Mama was talking. She said that our daddy was injured. I was scared because I didn't know if he was actually gonna come home or if he would just pass away. I don't know. Because I didn't know if they could fix it or anything.
What did he break?
Daddy has a head injury.
What did he get hit by?
I don't know.
Bomb.
Lexi used to ask me, Mommy, Daddy doesn't look like he's injured. Daddy doesn't look hurt. You know, it was really hard for them to even comprehend what had happened in Iraq, let alone a brain injury. So it was just little bits at a time that we tried to explain to him that the injury was inside Daddy's head. And that even though we couldn't see it, that there was still a problem.
He'd come in and yell at us, like, why isn't your room clean? Or why isn't this bed made correctly?
I got defensive, I got mad, and I was like, you know, I wanted to rage something that small, but really turned out to be something very big. And what was big was, you have a problem.
There was times that he could just scare the daylights out of me just by the look in his eyes. And that has a lot to do with the PTSD, too. So, I mean, he has severe PTSD along with a traumatic brain injury.
We'd get him so frustrated he'd have to leave the house or a certain room. And that when he comes back, he doesn't feel all happy, and he just wants some alone time. Like, if we want a hug from him, he says, go away.
I was in a denial stage, and I didn't want to accept that I had a problem. It took a while for me to get the pride to go away, and what it was that made me let the pride go was I was tearing my family apart.
Dear Diary, today my dad is upset. What did I do wrong? What can I do to make it better?
After an outburst, he would explain to him that he was, you know, look, Daddy got upset. Sometimes I just can't stop it, and I'm really sorry. But you know I love you, and I didn't mean anything by it. And he would give him a big hug, but to see your kids and your husband have to go through that is hard.
You know, I could give up on anything else, but I'm not going to give up on my children. I'm not going to quit on them.
You know, Isaiah came along 4 years after Michael's injury at a time when we needed something positive to happen instead of so much negative.
I believe my son to be my miracle because I honestly didn't think I was going to have another child. And then when he was born, it just meant a lot to me. And I had to condition myself and prepare myself with my psychiatrist because my issues from the war.
It was a big thing for him to make sure that he worked on the anger issues because I needed to go to work during the day and Michael was going to be a stay-at-home dad with Isaiah and he didn't want to get upset with an infant.
I wanted to better myself and I wanted the children to feel safe around me.
Anger management.
Isaiah is a new breath of life to show us that things aren't going to be bad all the time. That there are good things that can still come into your life even after the injury.
I had a chance to be a soldier. I love it. I want to be a soldier now. But it's all right, though, because I got the first best thing. Not the next best thing, but the first best thing, being a father.
I feel like I have to give him a bigger present in the world, but I just don't know what to give him. I mean, I give him my love. I give him presents for his birthday, Christmas, but I just feel that's not enough.
Give him your heart.
Lexi, everyone knows you write in a diary. How does that help you with your feelings?
It helps me with my feelings by, like if I'm sad and I did something wrong, I write it in a diary and it helps me relieve my sad or mad feelings.
Really?
Yes.
Wow.
What are some of the specific symptoms of Michael's traumatic brain injury and how do you and the kids adapt to it?
Well, one of the symptoms is short-term memory loss. And actually we have a new thing now in the house where we have to, Michael's keys, if his keys get lost in the house, it'll start World War III if we can't find the keys and everybody has to stop and find them. So we now have a thing where we have a peg on by the side of the door where we hang it on a certain peg every single time so that Michael knows where his keys are. Some of the other symptoms that he has are like fatigue. He does have migraines and he'll have seizures. And he also has sensitivity to light.
Oh, well, Emma thought Mr. Michael just wore those sunglasses because he's so cool.
Well, that too, Emma.
I think he looks cool, too.
Yeah.
Steve, as a psychiatrist, you work with and study families dealing with traumatic brain injuries or PTSD.
PTSD? Who's that?
Oh, PTSD. It stands for post-traumatic stress disorder.
Oh, Dr. Steve, what's that?
Well, Elmo, when people have PTSD, they have very scary memories or bad memories that can be so strong that it makes it very difficult for them to feel comfortable, and it can feel as though these bad things continue to go on even when they've stopped. And sometimes in combination with very intense feelings, whether that has to do with very strong feelings of anger or feelings of being scared, it can make it very difficult for them to feel as though they can connect with people, the people that they love the most.
Nico, you came back from Iraq with PTSD. How did it affect you?
You know, when I came home, I was very sad. I was very angry. It was really difficult to feel connected to my family in any way. I lost my smile, and that was really difficult.
I like to play with my mommy and daddy. It makes me happy.
I went to Iraq in 2006, 2007. It was pretty stressful. I think it was more stressful than I thought. And I don't think it really caught up to me until towards the end of deployment and really afterwards. When I got home, I felt completely detached from everything around me, everybody I loved, everything I cared about. And the worst was not feeling any love from my family.
Daddy was a little sad. I remember Daddy crying a lot.
He was trying his best to interact and play with his son. At the same time, he just, all that came out were cries.
Daddy was still in Iraq.
I was denying that it was anything remotely close to post-traumatic stress disorder. So now this is my fault. You know, I messed up. Oh, I must be weak. It was gradual. It took a lot of time going to support groups, being involved with just my family on a day-to-day basis really is helpful.
Oh yeah, there he is.
We're a long way from where we were 22 months ago. Rocco would give him a hug or a kiss and he was just numb. And he's not numb anymore. He can feel that, and that's the most precious thing.
Gonna be an acorn.
I love my daddy. I give my daddy big hugs.
I tell people Rocco saved me, him being there, seeing this smiling face every day.
He plays with me now, and we're all happier. I'm happy that my dad is home.
You're all better now?
I'm a lot better than I was, Rosita. But it takes a lot of work, and you have to stay at it. It's like exercising. You have to keep doing it all the time. You get a little stronger, a little better. But if you stop, you know, there's a chance that you can get worse again. So it's very important to keep on it.
Oh, that's really important. I mean, my father actually suffered from PTSD. He was a veteran of Vietnam. And I know he's helped a lot of his friends from Vietnam and from other wars to try to get treatment and get help. I mean, it was very challenging, too, for us as a family, so I can kind of relate to what the kids have gone through because it can challenge your relationships. And it was difficult for him and my mom at times. And, you know, just hard to deal with some of the emotions and the after effects. And then finally he sort of explained everything to me, what happened between you and mom, or what happened with our family. And he just really explained that he saw a lot of very difficult things that were hard to deal with, and it was hard for him to deal with them emotionally and psychologically. And I started to understand it. Luckily, he sought treatment, you know, just like you guys did, and it really made a big difference because it helped him to recognize, you know, what was going on.
Thank you for sharing that. And some people really need help, and it's important to remember the fact that there are good treatments for PTSD, whether it's therapy or medication, and they're available, and people should ask for them and take advantage of that.
So parents and kids have to know that it's okay to ask questions, to ask for help, and to just say what you need to say.
Say what you need to say.
Yeah. Yep, right, Isaiah? Hey, you know that song by John Mayer? Say?
Elmo loves that song.
Well, the words really ring true. You know, when a family is going through a big change, it's so important to talk about what you're feeling. That goes for parents and kids, too.
Yeah.
Take out every wasted hour, every little past frustration. Take all of the so-called problems, better put them in quotations. Say what you need to say. 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 Yeah. Walking like a one-man army, fighting with the shadows in your head, living out the same old moment, knowing you'd be better off instead. If you could only say what you need to say. 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 Never to say what you need to say again. even if your hands are shaking and your faith is broken, even as the eyes are closing, do it with a heart wide open. Why? Say what you need to say. Say what you need to say. Say what you need to say.
Say what you need to say. So you see, Rosita, there are lots of our friends and neighbors in the military who are going through changes because of injuries, and they all need our understanding and support.
Especially the kids.
But there are ways we can all help, right?
Well, sure there are. And the first step is simply reaching out and letting them know we are here for you.
Yeah.
Good night.
I love you. To learn more about this program, visit pbsparents.org.
Say what you need to say. Say what you need to say.
This program was made possible by the Iraq-Afghanistan Deployment Impact Fund of the California Community Foundation. Additional funding provided by American Greetings.
We are PBS.